Good morning, everyone. I'm Filippo Chiarello from the EUROM Organizing Committee, and I'm pleased to chair the first keynote of this second day of conference. Today will be with us Francesco Bartolucci, the star of the Latin Mark of Models. Francesco is professor of statistics at University of Perugia in the departments of economics. He's author of the book Latin Mark of Models for Longitudinal Data and co-authors of a number of statistical packages such as ELMEST, Multicert, and many others. His research interest goes from Latin variable models to marginal models for categorical data and longitudinal categorical data. Today's presentation will be about Latin Mark of Models for Longitudinal Data in R. By the ELMEST package. The package may be used to estimate different version of the LM model by maximum likelihood through the expectation maximization algorithms. So welcome, Francesco.
Hello.
And before leaving the e-floor to Francesco, remember that you can use our Slido to ask questions to the speaker. So, Francesco, the floor is yours.
Okay, so first of all, I would like to thank all the organizers for this very nice invitation and Filippo for this introduction. So, as said, my presentation is about latent Markov models for longitudinal data in R by LMS package. Essentially, my presentation is composed by two parts. First of all, I would like to introduce very briefly some elements of theory about latent Markov models, and then we go to illustrating the LMS package. So first of all, I would like to acknowledge that the LMS package has been implemented by several others apart from me, and so Silvia Pandolfi from the University of Perugia, Fulvia Pennoni from University of Milano Bicocca, Alessio Farcomeni from the University of Rome Tor Vergata, and Alessio Serafini from SOSE in Rome. The second part, which is also the main part of the presentation, will be based on some slides and an illustration that had been kindly prepared by Fulvia Pennoni from the University of Milano Bicocca and Silvia Pandolfi from the University of Perugia. So very few elements about the latent Markov models. So this is a very important model in the class of latent variable models in general. So I would like just to recall what is a latent variable model. Essentially, this is a statistical model including latent variables. And so variables that we cannot directly observe, but they are useful in several ways. So essentially, a latent variable model formulates assumptions on the conditional distribution of the responses denoted by Y, given the latent variables denoted by U, and given possible covariates. And so this is the so-called measurement model. And then there is a second component in a latent variable model, which is called a structural model, formulating assumption on the latent variable distribution given the covariates. It is well known that by marginalizing out the latent variables, we obtain the so-called manifest distribution, and through the Bayes theorem, we obtain the posterior distribution of the latent variables given the observable variables. So skipping some details, I would like just to say that it is very useful to include latent variables in a statistical model for several reasons. Here there is a list of possible reasons, such as modeling or accounting for the so-called unobserved heterogeneity, accounting for measurement errors, or summarizing different measures. So in the class of latent variable models, the latent Markov model is very important. This model is also called the hidden Markov model, but in particular when it is applied for the analysis of time series data. In this presentation, however, I will focus mainly on longitudinal data. In particular, the model may be used for the analysis of longitudinal, categorical, or continuous data. And here you have two main assumptions of this model. So first of all, suppose that for each individual I, where I goes from 1 to n, I observe a sequence of responses denoted by yi. The two assumptions are that of local independence. This is the main and the first assumption that says that the response variables in each vector yi are conditionally independent given a latent process. This latent process, denoted by ui, follows a first order Markov chain with a certain latent space, so state space, having k elements, denoted simply from 1 to k, and initial and transition probabilities, which are main parameters of the model. Please note that I denote by I the individual and by capital T the number of time occasions. So just to clarify the structure of the model, here I have a path representation of the model is the second graph here. And so in practice, we have a sequence of latent variables. And so latent variables by definition cannot be observed, but these latent variables affect the response variables. And as a comparison, in the first graph, I have a more standard framework, which is that of the so-called latent class model, which is, in other words, a finite mixture model for categorical data. It is important to note that in the latent class or in the finite mixture framework, I have only one latent variable affecting all responses. In the latent Markov or in the hidden Markov model, I have a sequence of latent variables. Each latent variable affects the corresponding response variable. So which are the main parameters of the model? The initial probabilities of the Markov chain, the transition probabilities of the Markov chain, that I will clarify through some examples, the interpretation of these parameters, and then I have parameters for the distribution of the response variables given the latent variables. It is well known that the transition probabilities will be collected in a matrix which is called a transition matrix. What is the manifest distribution? So the manifest distribution is the distribution of the response variables that is obtained by a suitable marginalization. Here we have some technical details, but I prefer to skip the details so that we can directly go to the illustration of a package. Essentially, in the first step, I obtain the conditional distribution of the responses given the latent variables. Then I have the distribution of the latent variables. By combining these elements, I obtain the manifest distribution. This manifest distribution is computed in practice by recursions, which are very popular in this literature due to Baum and Welch. I also very few elements about the possible extensions of this initial model, which is called the basic latent Markov model. So first of all, I can extend the model to the multivariate context in which I observe several response variables at each time occasion. So in this case, at each time occasion and for each individual I observe a vector of responses denoted by yit. Okay, so essentially, to simplify the model structure and also to have a particular interpretation of the model, I rely again on the assumption of local independence. And so the responses are conditionally independent given the latent variable, also for each time occasion. Another important point is that I can address the case of categorical response variables and that of continuous response variables. In the second case, the typical assumption is the same as multivariate normal finite mixture model. And so I assume that each vector of responses given the underlying latent variable as a normal distribution with a specific mean vector and common variance covariance metrics. Another interesting extension is due to the inclusion of individual covariates. And so it is important to recall that if covariates are available and they are represented by the vectors XIT, they can be included directly in the measurement model or in the structural model. Essentially, when they are included in the measurement model, I obtain an extension of a random FX model, which is very common in several fields, and in which I have a random intercept depending on the latent variable, and so this random intercept is time varying. Here we have the example of binary response variables. Essentially, and very briefly, I take each response variable, I consider the probability of success corresponding to each individual and time occasion, given the underlying latent variable and the covariates, and I model the logit for this probability as the random intercept plus the usual linear form depending on the covariates. In this way, I account for the so-called unobserved heterogeneity, so the heterogeneity that I cannot explain on the basis of the individual covariates. Another possible extension is based on including the covariates in the initial probability model and in the transition probability model. Again, very briefly, I use a logit or multinomial logit parametrization in which so I take, for instance, here the logit for each initial probability, and this logit is allowed to depend on the covariates available at the initial, at the first observation, okay? So at the beginning of a period observation. Regarding the modeling of transition probabilities, I again use multinomial logits. And so for each row, essentially, of a transition matrix, I implement a system or I obtain a vector of multinomial logits, and I assume that each multinomial logit is equal to a linear form depending on the covariates. In this second extension, the main interest is in the latent variables, which are seen as variables that I cannot directly observe, but they are measured through the response variables. And then I want to understand how these latent variables depend on the covariates. I have another possibility, which is that of a mixed latent Markov models. Essentially, in this case, I include in the model further latent variables of random FX and to account fully for the unobserved heterogeneity between individuals. For instance, here we include latent variables denoted by VI, where again I refers to the individual. And in practice, each VI spots in the population subpopulations which are not directly observed or latent clusters, and individuals in the same subpopulation is assumed to follow a certain latent class model. So in practice, I have initial transition probabilities which are specific for each subpopulation. And this is a way to cluster individuals, so to perform essentially a pattern recognition exercise in which in each cluster I have a different latent Markov model, okay? Really, few words about estimation. The main tool of estimation is based on the likelihood approach. And so to maximize this log-like function in this case, I will use the EM algorithm. Here we have the expression of a log-like function for a very simple case, so for the initial basic latent Markov model. So here I'm assuming that individuals are independent each other, and then they log likelihood is the sum of the log of the probability of each response configuration, of each individual response configuration. This log likelihood is maximized with respect to all model parameters, which are the initial probabilities, the transition probabilities, and the parameters for the conditional response, the conditional distribution of the responses given the latent variables. As usual, the EM algorithm alternates two steps until convergence, the so-called expectation step and the maximization step. At the expectation step, we compute the posterior distribution of the latent variables or latent process given the responses and possibly the covariates. At the M step, we maximize the so-called complete data log likelihood, or more precisely, the expected value of this complete data log likelihood, which is based on the results coming from the E step. As usual, I need the suitable recursions to implement the EM algorithm. A particular problem is that of multimodality of the log likelihood function, so that I have to try different starting values for the algorithm to be sure that I got the global maximum of the function, of the target function. And other two final issues are that of model selection, which may be based on the usual echaic information criterion or the Bayesian information criterion. And really, finally, for the theoretical part, there is a particular problem which is of great interest in applications of prediction of the latent states. Essentially, I'm performing the so-called decoding. So I want to understand, in brief, which is the latent state underlying each response referred to a given individual and time occasion. In this regard, there are two different approaches, the so-called local decoding and global decoding. If I'm applying a local decoding, it means that I'm predicting each single latent state. When I say single, I mean for a certain individual and time occasion. And I proceed as usual by spotting the maximum of the posterior probability of the latent state given the response configuration. But in this case, I predict each single latent state, okay, in a separate way with respect to other predictions. The second and more sophisticated approach is that of global decoding. In the global decoding, if I focus on a single individual I predict at the same time all the sequence of latent states, okay? And so I have to spot the maximum of the posterior probability of the entire sequence of latent states given his or her responses. This second task is more difficult, and it is performed through an iterative algorithm due to Viterbi, which is rather old, but is very efficient in terms of computational time. Okay, I will leave somehow the slides, and so I also left some references for the theoretical part. And now we can directly go to the LMS package. Okay, so already said by the chair of this section, this is a package that I implemented together with some colleagues that allows to specify and fit and in general make inference about latent Markov models in the basic version and in more advanced versions, including covariates or further random effects. Essentially, the main functions are devoted to the estimation from the maximum likelihood approach, and they are based on the expectation maximization algorithm. LMS package can be obviously installed from CRAN as usual, and we can start from illustrating the package. And so as usual, the main command is library or require lms to upload the package. And the package also includes a rather complete help as usual. And for citation, there is the usual citation command. Which are the main functions in the package? So there are functions devoted to data manipulation, and in particular, we will use the long format. So I recall that this is a framework for longitudinal data. And so I just very briefly recall that in this case, we have a sequence of observations, repeated observations in time, for typically a large number of individuals. And when I say a long format, it means that each record, essentially, in my database refers to a combination of individual and time occasion, okay? And so the overall number of records or the overall number of observations is in balanced cases equal to the product between the sample size and the number of time occasions. Then there are functions to specify the model, and so LMS formula, functions to fit the model for categorical data or continuous data. And then there are other functions, one to fit the mixed version that I just illustrated, functions to explore the possible models in terms of different specifications and then select the most suitable model for the data at issue for performing decoding, and to perform bootstrap resampling in order, for instance, to obtain standard errors for a parameter estimates. The bootstrap procedure is based on another function which may be used to simulate data from the assumed model. So in the package, there are also different data sets that I will use for the examples. I would like just to illustrate very briefly the data sets, even to give the idea of the possible problems that you can face through these models and through this package. So here I have the first data set, which is called RLMS long, longest for the format. And so it concerns the evaluation of job satisfaction provided by 1,700 more or less individuals followed for 7 years. So this data set come from the Russia Longitudinal Monitoring Survey. And here, you obviously, if you are interested, you can work by yourself on this package, but essentially this slide is important because it recalls and it shows what is the longitudinal format in the long shape, okay? So in this case, you can see that I have a line referring to a combination of time and individual, okay? And so for instance, I have for the first time occasion data for the first individual, for the second, and so on. Then there is another data set coming from the panel study of income dynamics, which is a very popular study in economics. In this case, the focus is on almost 1,500 women who were followed from 1987 to 1993, and I have two response variables, fertility and employment, and different covariates, such as age, number of children and family, and so on. And this data set is typically used in very important economic studies, for instance, to understand the relation between fertility and employment. Here again, we have an idea of the long format. You can realize that there is a record referred to each combination of individual and time occasion, and in each record you have in practice the list of the values of the covariates and of the response variables. First, we have the two response variables and then the covariates. I have another data set coming from the National Longitudinal Survey of YOF. And here I have around 600 individuals followed from 1990 to 1994. There are two response variables. The first, anti, providing a measure of antisocial behavior, and self, which is a measure of self-esteem. And I have also other covariates, but I can skip the details. If you are interested, you can have a look by yourself. And finally, there is a simulated data set about the criminal behavior of a large number of individuals. However, this is even if this is a simulated data set, it closely follows a data set that we used in a rather popular paper applying latent Markov models. Unfortunately, we cannot include the original data set in the package, and then we included a simulated version, so simulating the data from the parameter estimates. And then here the response variables are binary response variables referred to convictions for different crimes, referred to a large sample of individuals. Okay. Here in the package there are functions to organize and prepare the data, and the main function is LMS data. So here you have a typical example. In practice, if you run this command, for instance, referring to one of the data sets that I illustrated, this function LMS data provides a summary, okay? A summary of the main features of the data set in terms of number of observations, time occasions, variables, and description of the response variables and if there are of the covariates. This description is for all the time occasions together, so in a pooled way, or for each single year, okay? So for instance, time zero, time two, time four. So this is essentially a preliminary function that we use before estimating the model, okay? So here there is another application for other data, for instance, for the criminal data, but essentially we have the same type of output, okay? So please note that when I say observations or when you see observations, this is the overall number of observations, which is more or less the product between the number of people in the data set and the number of time occasions. I say more or less because sometimes you can have a different number of time occasions per each individual. Then, of greater interest is indeed function LMS formula. Through this function, you can specify the assumptions of the latent Markov model that you are going to fit. So essentially, as I already said in the theory, there are two components. I can put again the previous slides. There are two components of a latent variable model, and so of a latent Markov model. The so-called measurement model, referring to the conditional distribution of the responses given the latent variables and the covariates, and a second component, which is called structural model, referring to the distribution of the latent variables given the covariates. So here we follow this scheme, and so in LMS formula, I specify the two components, and so I have a first part for the response, and a second part for the latent initial and transition probabilities. And I can say that which are the covariates affecting the two components further to the latent variables. Okay. Here you have a first example of fitting this model. And so, for instance, I'm using the PSID long dataset in which I recall that I have two response variables and I allow four covariates affecting the responses, the latent variables, okay? And then I have to say which are the data, the number of latent states, the type of parameterization of the initial and transition probabilities, and I also have to specify the type of starting values for the algorithm, okay? So I also can require in output the standard errors for the parameter estimates, okay? Then here you have a basic output of the algorithm in terms of log likelihoods, parameter estimates, and so on. The main output is this. I can display the log likelihood function, the maximum of the log likelihood, the number of latent states, and the values of the two archaic Bayesian information criterion that may be used for model selection. Very briefly, in terms of parameter estimates, I can also have a nice interpretation using a function plot. For instance, here we have a display of the conditional response probabilities given the latent states. And so in this case, I have two items, two response variables, which are represented the first year and the second year. And each plot is referred to a different latent state. Since I have three latent states in this fitting, I have three plots, okay? So in the x-axis, I have the response, and in the year, I have the category, and here, I have the conditional response probability. I also can represent the transition matrix through a common plot, and in particular, here, we have three latent states, and this plot refers to the probability of transition, for instance, from the first latent state to the second, from the second to the third, and so on. For instance, I have a very high persistence in this case because the probability of remaining in the first latent state is very high, is very close to 0.9, okay? On the other hand, the probability, for instance, of moving from the first latent state to the second is around 0.12, and smaller is the probability of moving from the second to the first latent state. Okay, I don't know how much time I have.
A couple of minutes left.
Okay, thanks. Okay, so if I have a couple of minutes, I can also illustrate the case of continuous response variables. So essentially, here I'm using the other dataset, which is in the package, which is called NLSYLong. I have two response variables denoted by anti and self, so which are measured on a continuous scale. And so I use this command lmstcont, and you can see that there are two parts in specifying the model. So I specify the formula for the responses, and I write anti plus self, tilde null. Tilde null means that there are no covariates affecting the responses, but only the latent variables. And then we have the latent formula. In the first part, here I specify the covariates affecting the initial probabilities of the Markov chain. And here I list the covariates affecting the transition probabilities. In this case, I use the same set of covariates affecting the two model blocks. Again, I have to specify which is the indicator for the ID, so the identification number of individual, and for the time. I can use a range of k possible values from 1 to 5. So the function tries to fit the model with a different number of latent states, and then it spots the best one. And then I have other optional outputs. So in this case, we have a plot for model selection, again with a common plot. And we have two different criteria, a Kike information criterion and the Bayesian information criterion. And as usual, we have to look for the smallest value. For instance, if we use the second BAC, we go to select two latent classes because it corresponds, according to this plot, to the model with the lowest BAC. And then here we have a nice representation of the conditional distribution of the responses given the latent states. I have two latent states, more precisely, and then I have two different distributions for the response variables given the two latent states. The black curves are referred to the first latent state, and so the red curves to the second latent state. And you can see that we have different centers for these curves, okay? And so for the multivariate normal distribution, which is assumed for the response variables. Again, I can represent the transition through this plot that I find very nice. And so, as usual, I have the probability of remaining the same latent state denoted inside this circle. And then through these other arrows, I have the probability of moving, for instance, from the first to the second latent state and vice versa. I think that my time is expired. Is it?
Yeah, please.
Okay. Anyway, if you like, I can provide you with slides I can send to the organizers or put on my GitHub page if you prefer. Okay.
Okay. Thank you, Francesco. You can turn on your video again so that we can see you and stop sharing the slides. We can go into Slido. Thanks again for the presentation. We have collected a lot of questions, actually. So we still have some time in order to see them with you. Here, the first one, the most voted one, is asking about examples of practical use of Latin Markov models. So if you can give us some examples.
So, in the package, there are, as I told you, several data sets. If you are referring to the typical field of application, maybe if this is the question, the typical field of application is in economics, health, education, psychology. So essentially, when you observe a sequence of responses for a large number of individuals, these responses are organized in time, and you want to explain these responses on the basis of discrete latent variables. So the target in the end is that of clustering individuals according to the way in which they respond. So it's a typical exercise if you want of pattern recognition, but differently from other models as the classical finite mixture model, this clustering is performed in a dynamic fashion, in the sense that for each time occasion you have possibly a different cluster or set of clusters, and the individuals can change cluster across time. So this is a very important aspect of this cluster of models.
Okay. Please, Francesco, can you turn off your screen sharing so that we can see
this? Okay.
Thank you. So the second one is maybe for people who don't know much about LVM. So can you suggest any resources for LVM in R for newbies? So for new
By
people,
you mean
people that don't know anything about this topic. So if you can.
So you mean about the theory of the latent Markov models, you mean?
Well, I think both. So if you know of any.
We have a we wrote a book about latent Markov models, which contains an introduction of latent variable models in general. But obviously, I can suggest many other books, and they are listed in the bibliography that is in the end of my slides. For instance, there are very popular book. Or there is a very popular book by Professor Bartholomew, which is a very important researcher in this field. And there are many, many, many books apart from mine, but I can refer to the list of references in the end of my slides.
Thank you. So, next question is a bit more technical. So, does the method assume all individuals have the same time points, or can the time between measurement vary between individuals?
Okay, this question is very appropriate. So there are essentially two versions of this model, the discrete version or the continuous version. When I say discrete or continuous, is in time. Okay, so the basic version is the discrete version, that essentially it assumes that measurements are all at the same time occasions. Obviously, you can have missing responses, and so one observation may be skipped, but this is not a problem. But at least in principle, the measurements are all at the same time occasions. Then there is the continuous hidden Markov version that assumes that as said, the measurements are in any time occasion, and it may exist a difference from individual to individual in terms of time points of the observations. And so, at the moment in the package, we only have the discrete time version, which is anyway very important. But as I said, you can also have missing data for a certain time occasion, so this is not a problem. In the future, we plan to include also the time continuous version.
Okay. So next one, again, people is asking about applications. So here we have David that is asking about practical application of your package, if you know any. For instance, in marketing analysis. So if you know any applications in this field.
Yes. Indeed, this is a very important analysis. We have, together with Professor Pennoni, some experience about this. However, honestly, we have to admit that it is not easy to have public data about marketing applications. But we have some experience. And in this case, the main target is to perform a segmentation of customers. And this segmentation, or in other terms, clustering, is dynamic, as I already said. And so I can have a segmentation which is time varying. And I can also understand the evolution in terms of behavior of a customer across time. For instance, I can see if a customer, depending on goods that he or she buys, evolves in the behavior, moving from, for instance, the class or the cluster of a certain type of behavior to another cluster. Okay, and so I can also perform nice predictions in time based on the transition probabilities. And so, not only to study the evolution for the observed time occasions, but also predict the evolution for the next time occasions.
Okay.
One.
Next question is by Anne, who is asking if it's possible to extend the framework to support time-to-event survival outcomes.
Yes. Okay. So this is a nice question, because indeed Rather recently, with some authors that participated in the implementation of a package, we set up a so-called joint modeling framework in which we joint model survival and longitudinal data. And in practice, we share the latent variables between the two processes, the survival process and the longitudinal process. And this is very, now is a rather popular approach in medicine, obviously in particular. But typically it is faced with more traditional random effects models. In these very recent papers, we proposed to use the latent Markov model jointly with, for instance, a Cox proportional hazard model.
Okay, always Annie is asking another question that I read to you. There are a lot of distributional and structural assumptions here. How sensitive are the results to the assumption on covariates, outcomes, and latent variables?
Okay, so obviously this observation is correct. This is from a certain point of view a parametric model in the sense that we have many assumptions. However, it is important to note that we are in the field of discrete latent variable models. And so, indeed, we are not assuming a parametric distribution for the latent variables or for the random effects. So just to have a more precise idea, we have to consider that in a standard random effects model, the random effects, for instance, are assumed to have a normal distribution, which is a rather strict assumption. In our framework, we assume that the latent variables, which are the which are equivalent to the random effects, have a discrete distribution. But they are discrete, and the number of states or support points is arbitrary. Okay, and so it is very well known that using an arbitrary number of support points, I can approximate and reproduce in practice any distribution. Okay, and so this framework is not so strongly parametric as other latent variable or random effects approaches. And sometimes this is also called semi-parametric approach, in the sense that assuming a discrete distribution for the latent variables, I reduce the number, at most the number of parametric assumptions. But then I have some parametric assumption relating, for instance, the continuous responses to the latent variables. Okay?
Okay. Thank you, Francesco. Another technical question, and no, we have no more time. I'm sorry, but we will, so we can do something like that. We can give the questions to you, so maybe you can have some follow-up later. And I suggest to circulate, you can go in the lounge room, maybe meet some other people that wants to ask you something.
Thank you.
So thanks again, Francesco, for your presentation. Thank you very much. A clear presentation, even if of a technical topic. So thanks. Thank you very much. So thank you, and I hope that you will have a good continuation with our conference.
Many thanks to you.
See you soon, everyone. Bye-bye.